First, I want to give honor to God for just waking me up this morning and giving me this opportunity to present His word to you. And I believe that I do have a word from the Lord. So let us pray first, and then we'll go right to the scripture. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we come to you, Lord, and we just thank you for another day to give you praise, to give you honor, to give you glory. Father, I believe that you have given me a word for my brothers and sisters. Father, I pray that you would help me to deliver it with precision, Lord, that it would be clear, Father, that it would go down into the spirit man, and that it would bring forth fruit. And Father, we just praise you, we give you honor, we give you glory for all that you are and all that you do. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Okay, so we're going to read one scripture, which is Acts 16:11-15, but then I'm going to read into your hearing the second scripture, which will be our foundation scripture. So if you don't mind, can we stand as we read the word? And I believe that's the ESV version.
Verse number 9 and 10, we know that God had touched Paul.
Paul in a dream. He gave him a night vision, and he saw a man that was praying and urging Paul, come to Macedonia and bring us the gospel. So this, it was very intentional that Paul was going, because he was going as a response to that prayer that he heard in his dream or in that night vision. But I want you to see something, that before he even gets to any males, the first person that God has him to come to is a woman named Lydia. And she was in the place where she could receive from God. And where was that place? It was a place of prayer. So she was an immigrant woman that had been transported. She thought for one reason, but really it was for God's reason. And I believe many of you today are in this church right now. You might have thought you came to this country for one reason, but God is bringing you here for another reason. And it's for His purpose, and it's for His glory. So, the couple of things that we see about Lydia is the first thing that because... Two things. She had a heart that was opened by God. And the second thing is that her intent was to glorify God. And I believe that there are some women here whose heart has been opened by God, and their intent is to glorify God. But even Lydia had to go through a maturing process. Because the Bible says in Philippians 1:6, that he that begun a good work in us, he would continue it until the day of Jesus Christ. And if she continued to serve in the church, then she was going to have to go through a process. The Bible says that we go from faith to faith and glory to glory. But there is an in-between time. And I believe that my assignment here today is to show you what it is that you need to do to be prepared for where God is taking you. Because he's taking you to the next level spiritually, because he has another assignment that this church is getting ready to walk into. Amen. Amen. And so one of the things that God wants you to be able to do is that you have to examine where you are in your life. You have to examine whether or not your service is giving glory to God, or is it giving glory to you. And that's the title of our message. And that's the question that God wants me to help you to examine. Who's receiving the glory from your service and from your life? So who's receiving the glory? So now let's take a look at our scripture. So in the text that we just read, which was Romans 12:1 and verse number 2, there's two things that Paul teaches us there. One is that he shows us what it takes to have a life that is in position to receive from God so that you can go to the next level corporately and individually. And secondly, he shows us in verse number 2 is how do we do that? So that's what we're going to look at. So the three attributes: first, you have to present your body as a living sacrifice. The second two attributes on how do you do that, you cannot be conformed to the patterns of this world, the thinking of this world, but you have to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. But first, I want to set the stage for the book of Romans and just give you a little bit of background so you can understand what's going on that leads us to Paul writing Romans 12, verses 1 through 2. So first, we know that the book of Romans was written by the Apostle Paul, and it was written about 56 AD. And he was writing primarily to an audience that was Gentile, just meaning non-Jewish. And the Roman church was actually started, when you look at Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit fell, do you remember that? In Acts 2, when they were in the upper room? Well, during that time, those Jews actually went out, and some of them went to Rome, and they began house churches. So they began to spread the gospel, and the church in Rome began to grow. So at this point that he writes this letter, Paul had not yet visited Rome, but he knew that these are his brothers and sisters because they were in obedience to the gospel. The thing is that just like with any new thing is starting, there could be some confusion. And so there was confusion in Rome. And so Paul wanted to bring some clarification. So there's a lot of theological concepts in the book of Romans. But as a side note, I want you to take note as to who Paul entrusted this book to. Now think about it. This book has some rich theological concepts that are so deep that even some scholars today are kind of confused about it. But God chose a woman called Phoebe. He chose this woman to go from church to church, expounding, that means preaching and teaching these theological concepts to the church so that they can get the gospel message straight. They got things straight like sanctification and glorification, and what is salvation really about, and what is justification. So don't let anybody tell you that God doesn't use women to expound his gospel, because we have an example not only with Phoebe, but we also have it with Lydia. So now, so his main concern then was just to educate the believer in the basic doctrines of salvation. And what he wanted the church to understand is, how do you worship God in this new life that's submitted to Christ? And that's what we are going to uncover today. What does it mean to be a true worshiper? Because that's what Lydia was. And that's what I believe the women that are here and the men that are here, you're true worshipers of God. But now we have to always evaluate who's receiving the glory. Because we never want to mistake that, you know, we could be dedicated to Christian service, but then our life is not really submitted and surrendered to God. So we want there to be a balance in both sides. So now, let's go to the text, because I kind of took a long time here, but I just wanted to set the foundation. So in verse number 1, Paul says, and this is Romans 12, 1, so he says, I beseech you, some translations say, I beg you, or I urge you, or I plead with you. Therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, this is your reasonable service. So the first point that I want to make is that the word for service is also the same word for worship. And so what that tells us is that our service is our worship. When you're doing Christian service, you are actually worshiping God. But the other thing that may not be so evident in the English is that in the original language, it's in a tense that is what we call a continuous action, right? And so what that tells us is that you're presenting your bodies to Christ is an everyday ordeal for the rest of your Christian life until you see God. You have to get up and you have to be intentional about presenting your bodies to Christ. So now I want you to look at why he thinks that this is such an important thing. And the first word that whenever you look in a passage, and the very first word is always the most important word. And so that important word was beseech or beg. And really, if you look back in that time, we set ourselves as an audience that's receiving this directly from Paul. The picture that he would be painting is it's a military term. And if I were to say it in the Greek, it would be kaleo, right? And so basically, parakaleo. And what it means is just alongside, to call. And we'll see this word again in John 16 and 7. And it's the word that we use for the Holy Spirit. We call him the paraclete because he comes alongside. So Paul is saying to us, each one of us that have received Jesus Christ, the Lord, the Holy Spirit is with us. And he's along beside of us every day saying, now present your bodies as a living sacrifice. So he's pleading with us as a military term. Because if they would have heard it in that day, they would have taken two things from it. They would have said that this is a warning, but it's also an exhortation. Why is it a warning? It's a warning because the moment you get ready to position yourself for God, to do anything for him, you enter into warfare. Warfare with the flesh. You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
And so, yes, you do.
Amen.
Oh, think about it. Have you ever decided to pray and then your flesh wanted to go to sleep? The Lord said, get up at 4 a.m. And it's the one day that you can't get up because he wants you to fast. And the more he tells you to fast, the more your body wants to eat. Yes, it wants kimchi. Yes, 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 because the Lord said fast. So that's the warfare that you enter into. So now look, so now he's grabbing them because he's saying that I'm warning you, but he's also telling them that you can do it because that's what the military commander does. He said, listen, this is going to be a difficult battle, but you can win. You've been well equipped, and you all have been well equipped. We have been well equipped because we have the Holy Spirit. So now he grabs them, and then he uses a transitional word. This is important. He says, now therefore, by the mercies of God. And the reason he uses this word therefore is because he wants us to look back at the last 11 chapters, and when you see these things, then you should consider why you should present your body as a living sacrifice. So now, he says, therefore, by the mercies of God. Now, what are the mercies of God? I'm glad you asked. The mercies of God is the compassion and love of God. Let me just walk you through it very quickly. If you want to read through the book of Romans and get up to chapter 12, this is what you would see. In chapters 1 through 3, you would see the mercies of God that are reaching out to a lost humanity that was on its way to hell. That was you and I before Christ came into the picture. And he interrupted the process. It was because of his love. In chapters 3 and 4, we see the mercies of God that extended salvation to all ethnic groups and all people of different proclivities to sin. That's why we can be in here as an African American and as Korean and as white American and all come together because we received the salvation message, which was the mercies of God. It was the love of God. And so in chapters 5, we see the mercies of God as he gives us or extends to us and declares to us that we are justified. We are declared not guilty, even though we're guilty as sin. Yes, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then in verse number 6 and 8, and I'm going to move on, that the mercies of God came to set us free. We're free from the power of sin. So none of us have an excuse to say that I couldn't help myself, because you're free from the power of sin.
Amen.
Yes, and we're free from also the penalty of sin. So none of us, as we walk in Christ, will receive the penalty of the law, which sin is death. Amen? We will all have eternal life if we believe in the Father and the Son and what Jesus has done on Calvary. And then we're free, and here's the key, to become like Jesus. That means to have his character. And that's what this is all about. The Holy Spirit comes to make us more like Jesus, because the world should see us and see Jesus. They should not see Bonnie. They should not see my flesh. But they should see Christ's character and his love. So now, if we get that understanding, and Paul says, now you look back and you understand the mercies of God, and you understand how much God loved us and the price that he paid, he said that I got a heart of gratitude. The least you can do is to present your bodies, that's the plural, as a living sacrifice, okay? So now, I built the case because Paul built the case. He did it like a lawyer, like your pastor Sam would have done. And that's how Paul did it. So now we have the case to why we should be doing it. So now, what is it that we should be doing? And so, he says to present your body as a living sacrifice. And so that means that what are our bodies? And I'm going to slow down. I know I only have about 20 minutes, but I want you to understand this. Your bodies, we're made up just like the Levitical temple, because the Bible says that we are the temple of God. And so for each one of us, we have the flesh, and the flesh is how we communicate with the world, okay? So it represents your senses. It's what you smell, you touch, you see, you taste. This is why we have to be careful about the things that we allow to go into our ear gates, what we allow our eyes to see. Even, I think it was Job, he said, I make a covenant with my eyes. eyes. You know, when you're married, you should make a covenant with your eyes. When you're single, you should make a covenant with your eyes. And so, this is how we communicate with the world. It's like the outer court in the Levitical temple. But then we have the soul realm. And the soul realm, this is where our mind is, our will is, our intellect is, our emotion, okay? So that's the middle layer, if you will. And actually, that's the battleground. So I want you to see something. So you have the outer, which the world communicates with us, right? Or we communicate with the world. And then we have the innermost being, which is like the inner part of the holy temple. And so this is where God communicates with us. So you are a spirit with a soul, and you're embodied in the flesh. You understand? You got it?
Amen. Amen.
So now look at this, because I want to give you some scriptures to prove this point. The Bible says that in John 4:24, that God is a spirit, and that the way we worship him is in spirit and in truth. The Bible also says in John 6:63, that the word is spirit and it's life. So he uses his word to communicate to our spirit up into our soul. And the Bible also says that the only things that can really divide the soul from the spirit is the word of God. The Bible says that in Hebrews 4:12, that the word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, and it's able to separate the soul from the spirit. That's it, just the word. And then our bodies, like we said, is the temple of the Holy Spirit. So now, specifically, what does he want us to do? He wants us to be sacrificed and living holy and acceptable. Now, sacrifice and living, that's an oxymoron. Because to say that I'm a sacrifice, that means that I'm dead. But then it says that I have to be living. So then, Holy Spirit, what do you say? He's saying that you have to be dead to the outer world, which is the flesh, right? But you got to be alive to the innermost being. When the Holy Spirit came into you, he woke up your spirit. And now you are alive to Christ. He opened your heart just like he opened Lydia's heart. So now you are alive to the spirit. And you are to be dead to the world and the things of the world. And that just means the fleshly desires that are contrary to the word of God. So now how do you know that? Verse number 2 is going to help us to understand what are the things that are contrary to God's word, and how do I know how to discern the two? So this is what he's going to show us. But first we understand to be sacrificed just means that we got to be dead, and we have to be placed on the altar. Lydia, when Paul came to bring the word, she was in the place of God. And where was that? The place of prayer. And we know from her life, just those 4 verses, and also if we look at verse number 40, that not only was she in a place of prayer, so she was seeking the Lord, but we also know that she was attentive to the word. So it's one thing to hear the word, but the Bible says that Lydia heard the word and that she received it, and we know that she did it because, just to go back to the original language, we know that Paul was preaching the gospel when he was speaking to them about the word. But this is the deal. We know that she opened up and she did the word, because you know what? If you got faith and you have no works, the Bible says it's all dead. You understand? Because God has a requirement. So there, your faith should be in action. And this is what a Lydia heart is. It receives the word and then it begins to do it. Just like today, you're going to go home. Those that have Lydia heart, they will receive the word and begin to do what verse number 2 is going to tell us to do. So now, to be a living, that just means to be alive to Christ and to the will of the Father. And to be holy just means that you're consecrated and you are set apart. You got it? You're set apart for the work of Christ. So that means I get up in the morning, and this is what I do. I say, Lord, you take my hands and let me do your work. Let my feet go wherever it is that you want me to go. Let me speak what you want me to speak. Just like I said, Lord, I can't do this because I got so much going on in my plate. But then I came last week and I had to repent. And I had to say, yes, God, I'm going to speak your word because I believe that you've given me your word for my brothers and sisters here. Amen? So we can say no originally, but then we come back and we do the will of the Father. Spirit will convict us. And so then it says that it has to be acceptable. And this I want us to be real clear on, because this is key. It says that, you know, basically, God does not receive all Christian service. You know that? I know that might be hard to take, but everything that's done in His name, God doesn't receive it. I'm going to prove it to you by the scripture. Anything that's done in the flesh and any service that's done that does not give God glory, God doesn't receive it. He said, you can keep that and I'll take the glory. Because Isaiah 42:8 said that God does not share His glory with another. And He does not receive anything from the flesh, but everything that's done in the spirit and through faith. You know, so we can do things and we can be like, Lord, I'm doing this for your glory. And God will receive that. I don't care what it is. It could be picking up a piece of paper on His sanctuary floor. God will receive that as worship. You understand? Because you're doing it to give Him glory. And that's the key here. He wants us to give Him glory in everything that we do. So, I want to move right along. We're in time. All right, so I'm looking for it. So I just wanted to illustrate to you and just give you understanding of what I see in Lydia and then what I see in you when it comes to presenting your bodies as a living sacrifice. And so, you know, like we already stated that the most important thing is that she did open her heart to the Holy Spirit, and that we know from scriptures that she listened and she obeyed the word. But you know another thing about Lydia? And something that I noticed that's similar to this church is that she had a heart of hospitality. And for some reason in the church, we redefine what that means. But hospitality is what she showed to Paul and to Silas. She was a woman of means, but she was also the head of her household. And what she did was she actually opened up her house in her home and invited them in to come stay. Now, I want you to see something else. When we get to verse number 40, Paul and Silas, they had done something by delivering a woman from a demon, and it caused them to be whipped by, you know, the powers to be at that time. And they charged them, now I want you to leave this country or leave this city. And you know what they did? They went right back to Lydia's house. And now, if Lydia was going according to the world standard, and not being led by the Holy Spirit, she would have moved in fear. Because first of all, this is like bringing in a sect, you know, a new religion. And we know that you bring in a new religion, everybody wants to question you. But she followed the leading of the Holy Spirit, and even though she put herself at risk and her household, she still opened up her home to Paul and Silas. And here's the second key. She was busy doing the Lord's work. Because now, the Bible says, that when they came back, Lydia, now she's starting a church here, here's a house church, because there were believers, which meant that there were even some men there. So now God used these women, or this particular woman, to bring the gospel into a whole continent. And I don't know, but remember, there was a man that was praying that caused Paul to go there. But God used a woman, and then here comes the men. So I want to encourage you today that you might be here without your husbands, without your sons, but I believe that if you continue to keep your heart turned to God and keep Him as the priority of your life and present yourself before Him, don't worry about that. God said you and your household will be saved. And so I believe in that with my sisters, with my brothers, that you and your household, the gospel, each one of you were chosen as the vessel, just like Lydia, to have the gospel come through, and now a whole household, a city, and even a continent now have the gospel. And I believe that it's the same God. The Bible says in Hebrews 13:8-5, somewhere around there, it says God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. So I believe that same God that said her household and Lydia got baptized is the same God that can save my family and can save your family. Not only your husbands and your wives, but also your children and your grandchildren. Amen. So don't get weary. Don't get weary. Trust God. I believe it. And I believe it for you. So moving was dedicated to prayer. And I want to just move on because the time is going near. So that's what we have to do. And I'm going to go through verse number 2 pretty quickly, but this is how. And it is very important, but I can give you the notes. So how, verse number 2, he goes on to tell us how to live a life of a true worship. The first thing that it says is that you can't be conformed to this world. In other words, you can't allow this world to shape your thinking, okay? The patterns of the world. They say it's okay for men to marry men and women to marry women, but the Bible says, no, honey, it's a man and a wife. And so you can't be conformed and say, well, the world accepts this, so I accept it. So that's an example. But to bring it more personally, the world is self-centered. We even come up with new words. It's called selfie. We take pictures of ourselves because we're so in love with ourselves. That's the spirit of the world. I'm telling you, that's the spirit of the world. And we're not to be that kind of centeredness. We're to be God-centered people. Okay? And so we talked about to not conform to the world means that you have to watch your gaze because the subtlety of the enemy has crept into the church till we can't even tell what's God and what's not. That's why he's charging us today to say that you have to stay in a position where you can be led by the Holy Spirit and the Word of God can discern for you what is God and what is the world. That's why we gotta stay in the Word. That's why the enemy fights us to not study the Word and not stay in the presence of God. And so now, the next thing is that you have to die to your own desires. And then you have to be aligned to the will of God. And so now, the last part is that you have to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so that just means that you have to cast out, in 2 Corinthians 10:4-5, where it talks about the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to pulling down the strongholds. You have to cast out every imagination. You have to cast out everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Now again, how do you know what's exalting itself against the knowledge of God if you don't read your Bible? You can't know. So that's how you do it. You got to read the Word of God. And so now, this is how we war. And so now we have the mind. The Bible says let, and let is a warfare word. You got to let the mind of Christ be in you. And so and if you do that, the Bible says that the mind of Christ will rule your heart and the peace of Christ will rule your heart. So regardless of what's going on in the world, especially with this crazy election, if you're in the world, then the peace of God will rule your heart because you'll know the words that he's sovereign. Yes, he's sovereign and he's the one that puts authority into power. You see? And so we'll know, we'll have an understanding that when the word says 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people, that's us, which are called by my name, would humble themselves, would pray, would repent, he says, then God will hear from heaven and he'll heal the land. That's the only way all this foolishness is going to be healed. But we have to begin to repent. The church has to repent and seek the Lord. And so this is what God is saying, that we have to war in the spirit. So this is the last point that I want to make. Is how do you present your bodies as a living sacrifice? Every day you get up and just be intentional. Nothing mean. Just say, Lord, I give you myself today. And I want to be led by the Holy Spirit. You have to have a consistent prayer line. And that's in 1 Thessalonians 5:17. We should be praying with all of us. You have to have a consistent word life. Christians should never be without the Word of God. And then we have to be obedient to the leading of the Holy Spirit. If Paul wasn't obedient, the gospel would have never came to you. If Lydia wasn't obedient, then the gospel would have not come to Philippi. Because she was the vessel that God used to help Paul to launch his first missionary journey. So, when we surrender to the leading of the Holy Spirit will work. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So now, I just want to leave you with one last question. And I believe every one of us here today, including myself, we will be defined as true worshipers of Christ. So the question is not, do we want to live as true worshipers of Christ? But rather it's, are you willing to die to your own desires? Are you willing to give up this death row in order to gain everything that God has for you?
Amen.
When you present your bodies, your mind, your soul, your intellect, your fingers as instruments of righteousness and not of unrighteousness. Are you willing to do it? If you are, then you should be ready to answer this question. Who's receiving the glory? And my hope that everyone in this room will answer, it's God.
Amen.
So, Father, we just thank you so much for this word. And I pray, God, that if there was anything that was spoken that is not of you, that you would cancel out my brothers and sisters' spirit. But everything that was spoken of you, God, I pray that it would go down and that it would bring forth fruit. And that, God, that each one of our lives would be lived as a holy and acceptable sacrifice that's living, God. And that everything that we do, everything that we say, it would give you glory. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you. Appreciate your help. Wasn't that inspiring?
Yeah.
Yes. Awesome.
We will now have a brief communion service. The Intercultural Mission Church professes open communion, which means all who want to and able may participate. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. All who come to me shall not hunger, and all who believe in me shall not thirst. With Christians around the world and throughout the centuries, we gather around these symbols of bread and wine, simple elements that speak of nourishment and transformation. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you that you are as close to us as